بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله اللهم الآن أول طالب ظلم حق محمد وآل محمد وآخر تابع له على ظالم اللهم إن هذا يوم فرحت به آل زياد وآل مروان بقتل اللهم لعنهم جميعا السلام عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام أبدا ما بكيت وبكي الليل والنهار ولا جعل الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتي السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته Boy, today for the next hour or so, we are going to Karbala. We're going to Karbala with our hearts. And as we recite the Maqtal, and we narrate how the entire day of Ashoora happened, enter Janabaki in Karbala with your heart. And it is as if you were watching Imam Hussain. And every step Imam Hussain took on the day of Ashura, you were walking together with your Mawla. And all through, you're crying and you're beating your chest and you're wailing. And you are lamenting and you are saying, I wish I was there, Ya Aba Abdullah, so I could defend you. As the time of Fajr set in on the day of Ashura, Imam al-Hussain led the Salatul Fajr amongst his companions. He then stood up to deliver a khutbah. and he began to praise Allah and glorify Him. And then he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has permitted for you to be killed today, so you should remain patient and you should fight with courage. There were 77 men in total between the footmen and the horsemen. Imam al-Hussain then prepared his army for battle and arranged their ranks. Zuhair ibn al-Qain was made the commander of the right wing and Habib ibn Madahir was made in charge of the left wing. Imam al-Hussain and his family members remained in the center wing. Imam al-Hussain then gave the command to his brother Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. He made him the commander, he gave him the flag, and he appointed him as the standard bearer. Umar ibn Sa'ad al-La'in faced the Imam across the battlefield with 30,000 men. Amr ibn Hajjaj al-La'in was the commander of the right wing. Shimr bin Dhil Jawshan al-La'in was in charge of the left wing. Uzra ibn al-Qais al-La'in was in charge of the horsemen. And Shibith ibn Rabi' al-La'in was in charge of the foot soldiers. The armies of the enemies marched and circled around the tents of Imam al-Hussein, but they saw that the fire was ranging from the Khandaq. So Shimar al-La'in shouted out, Ya Aba Abdullah, you have prepared to go to the fire of hell even before the day of judgment has come. The Imam looked and said, Is this the voice of Shimar? Yes, he replied. Imam said to Shimar, Indeed, you are more worthy of the fire of Jahannam. Muslim Ibn Awsaja wanted to attack Shimar with an arrow, but Imam al-Hussein refused him by saying, I hate to be the one who starts the bloodshed. When Imam al-Hussein looked at the large fleet of the enemy's army, he raised his hands up in dua and he began to say, Allahumma anta thikati fi kulli karbin wa raja'i fi kulli shiddatin. Imam al-Hussein put his hands up in dua together with his companions. He said, Ya Allah, you are my only hope and my only help in all the times of difficulties. Imam al-Hussein then called for his camel and he rode it to the front of the army and he loudly addressed the people. He said to them, Ayyuhannas, listen to my words and do not rush to spill my blood until I admonish you with that which I owe you and so that I may tell you why I have come here. If you deal with me fairly, you will be much happier and you will see no reason to kill me. But if you do not accept my reason and you not deal with me justly, then be sure that my Lord is Allah who revealed the book and it is He who guards those that are righteous. And even if you go ahead to kill me. When the women of Imam al-Hussein heard the statement of Aba Abdullah, they began to weep and they began to wail. When Imam al-Hussein heard the crying of the women, he sent Abul Fadl al-Abbas and Ali al-Akbar to go to the tents and to ask them to remain quiet. For indeed, by Allah, the women have much to cry over the coming time. Imam al-Hussein then addressed the people and he said to them, Ibadallah, ittaqullah, O people, fear Allah in regards to the dunya. Had it been created for eternity, then you would have seen that the prophets of the past are more worthy of this dunya. But Allah has created the dunya as a temporary abode such that it may end. And be ready and prepare yourselves for the akhirah. The only way and the best way you can prepare for the akhirah is by having taqwa. Fear Allah so you may be successful. Ayyuhannas, Allah created this dunya as a temporary abode, moving from one condition to another. I can see that you have set your minds on spilling my blood, and if you do so, then the curse of Allah shall eternally remain upon you, and you will be the recipient of His wrath. How kind is our Lord, and how evil are His servants. You declared your obedience and your belief to Rasul Allah, and now you gather together to kill His progeny. Shaitan has taken full control over you and has made you forget the remembrance of Allah, and hence eternal damnation is your ultimate end. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Ayyuhannas, identify me, find out who I am, and then reflect over your evil souls and see whether whether it is lawful to kill me. Am I not the son of your prophet's daughter? Am I not the grandson of Rasulullah? Am I not the son of the first successor of the Holy Prophet? Isn't Sayyid al-Shuhada Hamza my uncle? Isn't Ja'far al-Tayyar my uncle? Have you not heard the Holy Prophet say about me and my brother, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, Sayyidi Shabab Ahli al-Jannah? If you do not believe in anything that I say, then ask the companions from amongst yourself. If this is not sufficient to stop you from shedding my blood, Shimar al-Na'in shouted out in response by saying, Hussein does not know how to worship Allah and he doesn't know what he is saying. Habib ibn Madahir got angry and he shouted out towards Shimar and he said, O Shimar, I testify that you are truthful when you say that you do not know what Hussein is saying, because by Allah he has indeed sealed your heart. Imam al-Hussein then went on to say, if you doubt in what I have said, do you really doubt that I am the son of your prophet's daughter? By Allah, there is no son of a prophet from the east of the world to the west of the earth, be it amongst our nation or amongst other nations. O people, why are you fighting against me? Are you seeking revenge for me for killing anyone of you? Or are you fighting because I have stolen your wealth? None of them could speak a word and none of them replied to the Imam. So Imam al-Hussein called out, he said, O Shibit ibn Rabi', O Hijr ibn Abjar, O Qais ibn Ash'ath, did you not write to me the letters in Kufa, and you are the ones who invited me to come, and you said that you would obey my commands? They all refused and they said, we didn't write the letters. Imam al-Hussein said, Subhanallah, indeed you did, but you were liars. The Imam then said, O people, if you hate me, let me go away to a safe and far away place in the earth. Qais ibn al-Ash'ath replied, why don't you accept the rule of Bani Umayyah? Indeed, they will treat you well and they shall not harm you. Imam al-Hussein said to him, do you want the Bani Hashim to seek from you more than the blood of Muslim bin Akil? Are you not the one who deceived Muslim bin Akil? Indeed, I shall not humiliate myself by succumbing to Yazid. Neither shall I flee away like a slave. O servants of Allah, I have sought refuge in Allah, and if you stone me and you attack me, I seek refuge in Him. A number of the men came charging towards Imam's direction, and one of them, Ibn Hawza, insulted the Imam. The Imam did a dua, Ya Allah, for his insults, send him into the fire of hell. Ibn Hawza continued to ride his horse, but his horse jumped over a rivulet. Ibn Hawza fell off his horse, his leg was stuck to a stirrup. The horse continued to run. Ibn Hawza began to hit his head on every tree and every stump until the horse threw him into the fire of the Khandaq and he burnt alive to death. إِلَى الْجَهَنَّمْ وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. The first mu'jiza of Imam al-Hussein on the day of Ashura, for which he did sajda to shukr. After this, Zuhayr ibn al-Kain came out riding a horse and he was in his full armor. He addressed the people and he said, O people of Kufa, be warned about the punishment of Allah. It is the obligation of every Muslim to warn and to guide his fellow brothers, and we are still brothers so long as the sword has not come between us. I deserve or you deserve to be guided. Once our swords are removed from their sheaths and once the blood is spilled, there is no brother, there is no more brotherhood between us. Do you not see what you have done to Aba Abdullah? You invited him and now you abandon him. Do not think that Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad will be a friend of yours, and do not take him to be a reliable leader. Indeed, he will kill the best of the people from you, just like the way he killed Hujr ibn Uday and he killed Hani ibn Urwa. In response, the people started abusing Zuhair ibn al-Qayn and they began to praise Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad. Shimr ibn Dil-Joshan shot Zuhair ibn al-Qayn with an arrow, saying to him to stop speaking and that Allah would silence him forever. Zuhair looked at Shimr ibn Dil-Joshan and he said to him, "Indeed, by Allah, you are an animal, and I do not fully think that you even understand two verses from the Book of Allah." Shimr al-La'in said, "Allah will soon kill you and your master." For Zuhair ibn al-Qayn said to him, "Are you scaring me with death? Indeed, death with Hussein is more pleasant for me than to live forever with amongst people like yourselves." One of the companions then called back Zuhair ibn al-Qayn and he said to him, "Imam al-Hussein is calling you back." He returned back, Imam al-Hussein thanked Zuhair ibn al-Qayn and he said to him, "You are like the mu'min of Al Fir'aun. You exceeded in eloquence by giving guidance, but it did not benefit such people." After Zuhair, Burayr ibn al-Khudayr came out with the permission of Imam al-Hussein to address the people. He was from the Tabi'iyyin and the most prominent reciters and the memorizers of Quran. He was well respected among the people of Hamadan. He addressed the people by saying, "Ya ma'shar al-nas, Allah sent Rasulullah as a bearer of glad tidings and a warner from Jahannam. He invited you towards the path of eternal happiness. Is this how you reward the family of the Holy Prophet? By denying them the water of Furat, even the pigs and the dogs drink from the river Furat, yet the children of Hussein are thirsty and weeping." They said to him, "O Burayr, you have said too much. Spare us your speech. By Allah, Hussein shall suffer thirst, just like the way Uthman ibn Affan had suffered from thirst." Burayr then said to them, "O people, how will you answer Rasulullah on the day of judgment? Indeed, how evil have you been in succeeding the Holy Prophet?" Imam al-Hussein then rode into the Maidan for a second time with his horse and he placed a copy of the Quran over his head and then he stood in front of the people and he said, "O people, the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah, the Messenger of God, is the judge between you and me." Imam al-Hussein then removed his sword. Imam al-Hussein removed his amama. Imam al-Hussein removed his armor. He put it forward for the people and he said to them, "O people, is this not the sword of Rasulullah? Is this not the amama of Rasulullah?" They all said yes. So Imam al-Hussein said to them, "Then why do you want to kill me when you know that I am the grandson of the Prophet of Islam?" They said that we are doing so out of obedience to the governor, Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad. Imam Hussein then addressed them by saying, "Woe unto you, O people of shame. You have invited us and now you turn your swords against us. You sided with our enemies and went against your friends. You abandoned us by keeping your swords in their scabbards when we needed them most. By Allah, it is your old age and it is be your behavior of treachery and desert and your lack of loyalty which has brought us to these plains of Karbala. And then Imam Al-Hussain went on to say, Ala wa inna al-da'i ibn al-da'i kad rakkaza bayna athnatayn bayna al-sillati wal-dhilla wa hayhat minna al-dhilla. Imam Al-Hussain then said, Allah Himself refuses that we should ever be humiliated. We are people of dignity and we are people of honor who would rather die with our honor rather than to be subjected to eternal humiliation by being betrayed and siding with those who promised to support me. The Imam then recited verses of the Quran. The Imam then recited verses of the Quran and he returned back to the camp. Imam Al-Hussain then called for Umar ibn Sa'ad and he said to him, O Umar, do you really think that if you kill me, the illegitimate son will make you the wali of the land of Ray? By Allah, you shall never become the governor. You will not be happy with the dunya, neither will you be happy in the akhirah. Umar ibn Sa'ad turned away from Imam Al-Hussain. After this, as this was happening, in the meantime, Khur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi repented and he joined the ranks of Imam Al-Hussain. He came towards Imam Al-Hussain with his spear upside down and his shield inverted up. He came towards the Imam and he said to him, I apologize for all the troubles and for placing you under siege in Karbala. Will you accept my tawbah, O my master? Imam Al-Hussain accepted the tawbah of Khur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi. Umar ibn Sa'ad then advanced towards the troops of Imam Al-Hussain. He put an arrow in his bow and he shot it towards the direction of the Khaymagah. The arrow of Umar ibn Sa'ad pierced the tents of the ladies. They began to shout and they began to weep out of fear. And then Umar ibn Sa'ad proudly turned around and he said to his people, bear witness for me in front of Yazid that I was the first one to shoot the arrow in the tents of Imam Al-Hussain. When all the people saw that Umar ibn Sa'ad has shot the first arrow, each and every one took off their arrows and 4,000 arrows were shot towards the direction of Imam Al-Hussain. Allahu Akbar. Ahibai, this is now the beginning of the battle of Ashoora. The enemy forces have now begun to shoot arrows towards the camps and the tents of Imam Al-Hussain. This is now the beginning of the day of Ashoora. This is the Qiyamah of Ali Muhammad on earth. This is the day Imam Al-Hujjah weeps tears. Allah, Allah. Imam Al-Hussain said to his companions, stand firm and meet your death. May Allah have mercy upon you. These arrows are the messages of war from the people. Imam Al-Hussain arranged his forces in the rank. He cried out, Bismillahi wa billah, wa fi sabilillah, wa ala millati rasulillah. The army of Haq clashed with the army of Iblis. The beating of the drums and the clashing of the swords. Blood was gushing in the air. The battle raged for some time. By the time the thick cloud of dust settled down and everyone retreated back. This army, the Maqtal narrates that 50 men from the army of Imam Al-Hussain had been killed and were lying on the plains. When Imam Al-Hussain saw the large number of his companions that had been killed, he placed his hand on his beard and then he raised his hands to the sky. He said, the anger of Allah fell upon the Jews for having attributed a son to him, and the anger of Allah intensified upon the Christians because they made him one of three. The anger of Allah now falls upon the Muslim Ummah for the manner in which they killed the son of their prophet. By Allah, I shall never agree with them about anything they want me to do until I meet Allah drenched in my blood. The Imam then called out, Al-min nasirin yansuruna Al-min mughithin yughithuna. Is there anyone to help us? Is there anyone to defend the women of the Messenger of Rasulullah? The women began to weep and wail when Sa'ad ibn al-Harith and his brother Abu al-Hutuf, when they heard the cry of Imam al-Hussain, they were both in the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad. When they saw the cry of Imam al-Hussain, they realized their sin. They went and they repented from Imam. They turned around against the army of Umar ibn Sa'ad and they shot them with arrows until both of them became shaheed. Having seen how their numbers were quickly diminishing, the Imam's companions resorted to one-on-one duels and were able to kill large numbers from the Kufans and the Kuffar. Amr ibn Hujjaj al-La'in shouted out to his men, "Do you know who you are fighting against? These are the warriors of the earth, the people of vision who will stay firm until death. None of you should come out to fight them unless that he is getting killed despite their small numbers. By Allah, if you all gather together and throw stones at them, you will be able to kill them." Umar ibn Sa'ad agreed and he sent an order to the army refusing anyone to come out in a single combat. Amr ibn Hujjaj al-La'in then attacked the right wing of Imam al-Hussein's army, but the companions kneeled down on their knees, they planted forward their spears and they prevented the horses from advancing any closer and hence maintaining their ground. When the enemy's horses tried to charge at them for a second time, Imam al-Hussein's companions shot the enemies with arrows, injuring some of them and killing a great number of them. Amr ibn Hajjaj kept telling his men, "Attack the people who abandoned the creed of Rasulullah." Imam al-Hussein looked at him and he said, "Is it me who abandoned the creed or is it you? Woe upon you." The intense fighting lasted for quite some time. When the dust settled down, Muslim ibn Awsaja, who was defending the side of the Furat, was seen lying down on the ground covered in wounds. Imam al-Hussein and Habib ibn Madahir came towards Muslim ibn Awsaja. Imam al-Hussein sat by Muslim and he said to him, "Rahimakallah ya Muslim, minhum man qada wa minhum yantadir wa ma baddalu tabdi." Habib bent down by the side of Muslim ibn Awsaja. He said to him, "O Muslim, if I had known that I am going to live for a long time after you, I would have asked you to give me your wasiyah such that I may carry it out." Muslim ibn Awsaja very faintly called Habib. He pointed towards Imam al-Hussein and then he said to him, "Habib, my final wasiyah is that you look after Imam al-Hussein. My final wasiyah is that you look after Imam al-Hussein and defend him until your death." Habib said, "Indeed, that I shall do." Shimar al-La'in, together with his horsemen, then attacked the right wing of Imam al-Hussein's army, but they remained firm and they forced Shimar and his army to retreat. In the encounter, Abu Wahab killed 19 men and 12 foot soldiers. However, as the fighting continued, his right hand was severed, his left leg was cut off. He was then taken a prisoner and he was instantly killed. They severed his head. Shimar ibn al-Joshan lifted the head of Abu Wahab and threw it into the camps of Imam al-Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Shimar then launched an attack and then again on the tents for a third time. he threw his spear towards the tents of Imam al-Hussein, and then he said to the people, bring me fire such that I can burn the tents of Hussein with his women inside. Imam al-Hussein said to him, O son of Dhil-Joshan, will you burn my tents while my family is alive in it? So Zuhair ibn al-Kain attacked Shimr with a group of 10 men until they dispersed them from around the tents. Umar ibn Sa'ad then sent a reinforcement of 500 foot soldiers, and the fighting intensified. The Imam's companions suffered most of the wounds. And despite this, their enemies were not able to penetrate the tents because they were pitched close to each other. Umar ibn Sa'ad then ordered his men to try and attack the tents again. The companions of the Imam stood in groups of threes and fours in front of each tent, killing and attacking anyone who would even come close to the tents. Abu Thumama then, during the heat of the battle, looked up towards the sky. He noticed that it was the time of noon. He said to Imam al-Hussein, may I be sacrificed for you? These people have come close to us, but by Allah, I shall not be killed before I die defending you. And I love to return to Allah after having performed my salat, because the time has approached. Imam al-Hussein raised his head towards the sky. He said to Abu Thumama, ذَكَرْتَ الصَّلَاةِ جَعَلَكَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ الظَّاكِرِينَ. Because you have remembered the salat, may Allah elevate your status and make you from the dhakirin. Imam al-Hussein then said to Abu Thumama, tell Shimr and Umar ibn Sa'ad to stop the war and give us a chance to recite our salat. Al-Hasin, la'natullahi alayh, when he heard the Imam wanted to pray salat, he shouted out and he said, O Hussein, do you think your prayer is going to be accepted? Allah shall never accept your prayer. At this point, Habib ibn Madahir got angry and he said to him, O Hasim, you son of a donkey, do you think the prayers of a prophet is not accepted? Do you think the prayers of the family of the prophet is not accepted and yours will be accepted? So Hasim challenged him to a duel. Habib ibn Madahir went into the Maidan, and despite his old age, he killed 62 men from the Kuffar, until one of the enemies by the name of Badil ibn Surayh, he attacked Habib ibn Madahir with a sword. As another person of Tamim came towards him, they pierced the back of Habib ibn Madahir with a spear. When Habib fell down to the ground, blood was coming out from his back. He tried to stand up again, and Hasin came and struck Habib on the head with a sword, causing him to fall down face first. A man from Tamim came and began to cut the head of Habib ibn Madahir. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. After Habib, Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi came up to fight together with Zuhair ibn al-Qain. Both of them, they performed the jihad until Hur became shaheed. After that, the companions began to perform their salat. Imam al-Hussein was leading the salat in the form of Salatul Khawf. Zuhair ibn al-Qain and Sa'id ibn Abdullah al-Hanafi were standing in front of Imam al-Hussein, protecting him while he was reciting the salat. When Imam al-Hussein finished reciting the salat, Sa'id fell down to the ground with number of injuries. He looked at Imam covered in blood, his face and his chest and his legs. He turned around to Imam al-Hussein and he asked him, O Yabna Rasulullah, have I fulfilled my obligations towards you? Imam al-Hussein said, of course you have, Ya Sa'id, you are going to enter paradise before me. This is the when he looked at Imam al-Hussein for for the last time, Sa'id closed his eyes and departed towards heaven. When his body was carried out, they found 13 arrows were planted in the chest of Sa'id. Imam Hussain then addressed his companions by saying, O companions, do not lose your courage, for indeed the victory of Allah and the promises of heaven, the gates are open in front of you. The fighting after Salatul Dhuhr became even more intense, and whoever would go to fight in the battlefield would not return back alive. Every time a companion went into the battlefield, he would end up saying, or he would bid farewell by saying, Assalamu alayka ibn Rasulullah. Imam al-Hussein would reply by saying, Wa alayka salam wa nahnu khalfak. Alayka salam, don't worry, we are following you to Jannah. Abu Thumama then came out to fight until he was killed, and after him Qais ibn Abdullah attacked him and killed him, and then Sarman ibn Madarib, the cousin of Zuhair ibn al-Kain, came out to fight until he was killed. Zuhair ibn al-Kain then also asked for permission. He put his hand on the shoulder of Imam al-Hussein and he said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, indeed when I get killed in the Maidan, I shall be raised towards heaven. Today is the day I meet Rasulullah. Today is the day I meet Ali al-Murtada. Today is the day I meet Hasan al-Mujtaba. And then Zuhair ibn al-Kain went into the Maidan and he fought a ferocious jihad. He killed 120 people from the Kuffar until they gathered around him and they struck him on his head. Amr ibn Qazai al-Ansari came and stood in front of the Imam, protecting him from the enemies, until he was shaheed by receiving 25 wounds from the swords in his chest and his back. One by one, each of the companions went into the battlefield, and one by one, each of them fought until they were killed valiantly. One of the last companions to go into the Maqtal was John, the slave of Abu Dhar. He asked for the permission of Aba Abdullah to go and fight. John was elderly in age, for Imam al-Hussein said to him, O John, due to your age, you are exempted from jihad. John fell down and began to kiss the feet of Imam al-Hussein. He said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, O my master, I may be dark and I know that I do not smell nicely. I do not smell or I do not have a good fragrance, but I want my blood to be mixed with your blood. Imam al-Hussein gave him permission to go. John, despite his old age, had a bandage around his head and he had tied a cloth around his back so that he could stand straight. John went into the battlefield and he killed 25 of the kuffar, sending them to Jahannam wa bi'sa al-masir, until they struck him also on his back and on his head. When John fell down to the ground, Imam al-Hussein went towards John. He put his cheek on the cheek of John. He wiped the blood from the face of John and he said to him, You are now going to be with my grandfather in heaven. The Kuffar mentioned every time they passed the body of John, they would smell the fragrance of musk coming out from the body of John. Like this, each and every one of the companions became shaheed. And a matter of time after Dhuhr, no one remained with Imam al-Hussein except for the youth of Bani Hashim. No one remained with Imam al-Hussein except the youth from Bani Hashim. At this moment, each and every one of the youth came to Imam Al-Hussein seeking permission to be the first one to become Shaheed. Ali Akbar wanted to be the first one. Abdullah, the son of Muslim bin Akil, wanted to be the first one. Qasim also wanted to go into the battlefield. They were all asking for permission. The first one being Abu Hassan, Ali Yunil Akbar. When the women of the household saw Ali Yunil Akbar, they all began to surround him and they began to weep. Sayyidah Zainab said, "Have mercy on my loneliness in this strange land. We cannot bear your separation." Ali Yunil Akbar sought permission from his father and he went into the battlefield riding his father's horse. He attacked the enemies fiercely while saying, "I am Ali, the son of Hussein, the son of Ali. We are indeed by the Lord of by the house of Allah more worthy than the Nabi. Indeed, we shall never be ruled by the illegitimate children, and I shall strike the enemies with my sword and protect my father with a strike that is Hashimi and a strike that is Qarashi." Imam al-Hussein looked at the jihad of Ali ibn al-Akbar with great grief in his eyes. His eyes were filled with tears. He shouted out towards Umar ibn Sa'ad, "What is wrong with you? May Allah cut your lineage just like the way you are cutting my lineage. You have not respected my kinship to the Prophet. May you be slain in your own bed." And then Imam al-Hussein began to recite the verse of the Quran, "Inna Allah astafa Adama wa Nuhan wa Ali Ibrahim wa Ali Imran ala al-alamin dhurriyatun ba'duha min ba'din wallahu sami'un alim." Imam al-Hussein cried out and said, "This is the person who reflects and resembles Rasulullah, the closest on earth." Ali ibn al-Akbar kept attacking the right wing, dispensing them to the left and killing 120 of the horsemen. فَحَتَّى إِنْكَلَبَ مَيْمَنَتَهُمْ مَيْسَرًا وَمَيْسَرَتَهُمْ مَيْمَنًا. He threw the entire army into confusion and disarray due to the intensity of his jihad. Ali ibn al-Akbar then returned back to Imam al-Hussein, complaining about the thirst and the heaviness of the armor. Imam al-Hussein began to weep and said to him, "Oh my son, you are going to meet your grandfather who will feed you from the cup of Kawthar." Ali ibn al-Akbar then returned to the battlefield. He intensified the attack, killing a further 200 soldiers from the enemies. Murra ibn Munkir then attacked Ali ibn al-Akbar. He lodged the spear in his back and then he struck Ali ibn al-Akbar with the sword on his head. The skull of Ali ibn Akbar was split open. Ali ibn Akbar hacked the neck of the horse, but as the blood from his head began to flow down onto the face of the horse was not able to see where it was going, so it ran into the directions of the enemies. They surrounded Ali ibn Akbar. They attacked him from every direction. This one hit him with a sword, this one with a spear. The Maqtal says, فَقَتَّعُوهُ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا. They cut Ali ibn al-Akbar to pieces until he fell off his horse. He said, "Assalamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah." Imam al-Hussein went running towards Ali ibn al-Akbar. When he sat by his side, he put his cheek on the cheek of Ali ibn al-Akbar. He wiped the sand and the blood from his face. Ali ibn al-Akbar said to him, "Oh my father, I can see my grandfather Ali and my grandfather Fatima. They have come to me with a cup of water from the pond of Kawthar and they're saying, 'Tell your father to come back.'" Imam al-Hussein took a handful of blood from the chest of Ali ibn al-Akbar. He threw it towards the heaven and not a single drop fell back down to the earth. After Ali ibn al-Akbar, Abdullah, the son of Muslim bin Akil, came out to fight, saying, "Today I shall meet my father, Muslim bin Akil." He went and he attacked the enemies with intensity until they surrounded him from every direction. One of the enemies shot an arrow towards Abdullah ibn Muslim. Because of his proximity, Abdullah tried to cover his face with his hand. The arrow pierced the palm of Abdullah and his palm got stuck towards his forehead. He was not able to remove the arrow from his forehead, so he said, "Ya Allah, they have humiliated us, so avenge for us." While he was in this state, an enemy came and he launched a spear into the chest of Abdullah ibn Muslim bin Akil, killing him. Thereafter, the family of Abu Talib indulged in collective attacks, one after one. They went out to fight, each and every one of them gaining shahada. The children of Abdullah ibn Ja'far and Sayyida Zainab al-Kubra, his brother Muhammad Aun, and then Abdul Rahman, the son of Akil. They all went into the battlefield, and then went the elder brothers of Shah Qasim, Hasan al-Muthanna, the eldest son of Imam al-Mujtaba. He received 18 wounds and his hand was severed, and then he became unconscious in the middle of the battlefield. Imam al-Hussein began to weep and cry when he saw that the youth of Bani Hashim, each and every one of them, are becoming shaheed. After some time, Qasim came to seek for permission. Qasim, the son of Imam al-Hasan, he was barely of age. When the Imam looked at him, he began to weep bitterly and hugged him. He came out to the battle facing the enemies and killed 70 of them. And then the lace of his sandal became untied. He bent down to tie the lace as if to say, "I don't care about the enemies." At this moment, Amr ibn Sa'id came. He attacked Qasim by striking his head with a sword. Qasim fell down to the ground and shouted out, "Ya Amma Adrikni." Qasim's mother was standing by the Khaymagah. Qasim's mother was standing by the Khaymagah. The horses of Karbala were running in every direction. When she saw her son in a state, she fell down to the front of the tents. Imam al-Hussein came charging like a lion to attend to edge Qasim. By the time Imam reached Qasim, he saw he was moving his legs up and down due to the intensity of the pain. He sat by the body of Qasim and he said to him, "How difficult is it on your uncle that you called him and he was not able to help you?" When all the children of Bani Hashim had become shaheed, Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas looked towards his brothers Abdullah, Uthman and Ja'far and sent them to go into the battlefield to sacrifice their lives. Each and every one of them did the jihad until they became shaheed. And then Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas went towards the Khaymagah. He sought permission from Imam al-Hussein. He said to him, "I cannot bear these munafiqeen anymore." Imam al-Hussein looked at Abu al-Fadl and he said to him, "Ya Akhi, Anta sahibu liwa'i." "O Abbas, you are the standard bearer of my army. O Abbas, if you go into the battlefield, I do not have an army anymore." And then Imam al-Hussein gave him permission to go and seek some water, to fetch some water. Abu al-Fadl went into the Maidan. He cried out, "O Umar ibn Sa'ad, this is the son of the daughter of the Prophet thirsty, and his children are suffering of thirst. Give them some water." for their hearts are burning. 3 days of thirst, the children were crying, Al-Atash, Al-Atash. As he kept saying this, he then went on to say, leave us and let us go towards Rome, or let us go towards India, and we shall leave Hijaz and Iraq for you. Shimmer shouted out, O son of Abu Turab, even if the entire dunya was with water, we shall not allow you to drink from it. Abu Fadil went back into the tent. He got his sword, he got his armor, and he took the water bag, the mashk, from the youngest daughter of Imam Hussain by the name of Sakina Rukayyani. He then rode into the battlefield and he attacked the enemies ferociously until he got towards Shimmer had posted 4,000 archers next to the Furat. Imam Abbas went and dispatched each and every one of them. They flew in every direction. He conquered the river Furat, and then he said, he picked up a handful of water. He looked at the water and he said, Ya nafsu ba'da al-Husayni huni wa ba'dahu la kunti antakuni. Abu al-Fadil looked at the water and he said, Oh nafs, how can you drink the water while Hussein is thirsty? Indeed, I shall never drink the water while my master is thirsty. Abu al-Fadil filled the mashk with water and began to ride his horse back towards the tent. The enemies attacked him from every direction, but Abu al-Fadil protected the water bag. Towards the end, one of the enemies hid behind a palm tree. Zayd ibn Rukad waited when Abu al-Fadil passed by. Zayd cut off the right arm of Abu al-Fadil and Abbas. Allah, Allah, the arm of Abbas fell towards the ground. He was bleeding. Abu al-Fadil cried out at this point, Wallahi in qata'tumu yamini fa'inni uhami abadan andini wa'an imamin sadiqil yakini. Even if you cut my right hand, I shall continue to defend the imam of my time. I shall continue to defend the deen. Abu al-Fadil continued to fight until an enemy came and waited for him at the palm tree again. When Abu al-Fadil passed through, they severed the left arm of Abu al-Fadil. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, sitting on a horse without any arms, he cried out and he said, Ya nafsu la takshi min al-kuffar, wabshiri bil ahmatil jabbar. O nafs, do not be scared of the enemies and look forward towards the mercy of your Lord. They cut my left arm out of hatred. O Allah, place them towards hell. When Abu al-Fadil had no arms, the enemies began to attack him from every direction. They began to shoot arrows at him. One arrow pierced the chest of Abu al-Fadil. Another arrow pierced the eye of Abbas. And a third arrow pierced the mashk, which was around his chest. As the water began to pour down, one of the enemies came and he hit Abu al-Fadil with a tent pole at the back of his head. Abu al-Fadil fell down from the horse face first. The arrow in his eye got pushed deeper in. He cried out, Alayka minni salam, Ya Mawlaya, Ya Sayyidi, Ya Aba Abdullah. Imam al-Hussein ran towards Abbas with great difficulty. When he saw the state of Abbas, he said, Al-an inkasara dhahri wa qallat hilati. Now indeed my back is broken. Now my enemies shall ridicule me. Imam al-Hussein sat by the side of Abu al-Fadil. Imam al-Abbas refused for his body to be taken back to the Khaymagah. When Imam al-Hussein returned back to the tent, he was wiping his tears with his sleeves. Sugaina came out and she said to him, Has my uncle come back with water? Imam al-Hussein did not know how to reply to his daughter. daughter. So he remained silent. Sugaina asked again, "Oh my father, where is my uncle Abbas?" Imam Hussain was not able to say to her, so he began to break down, so he began to dismantle the tent of Abul Fadl. When she saw her father is closing up the tent of Abbas, she understood that Abul Fadl is shaheed by the Furat. Imam Hussain stood in the middle of the Khaybaga. He cried out, "Hal min nasirin yansurana? Hal min mughithin yughithuna?" At this moment, Imam Zainul Abidin stood up. Imam Zainul Abidin, who was sick with a lot of difficulty, stood up. He was supporting himself with a stick in one hand and a sword in the other hand. He tried to come out of the Khaymagah, but when Imam al-Hussein saw him, he cried out to Sayyida Zainab. She said to him, "Oh Zainab, take Sajjad back into the Khaymagah, lest the lineage of the nasal of Ali Muhammad is finished by Sajjad being killed." The Imam then went into the tent to bid his family farewell. He asked Sayyida Zainab to bring for him a dark colored robe, a dark colored abba. And then he asked for the abba of Rasulullah. He wore the turban or the amama of Rasulullah, but he kept the two ends of his amama open. He then took the sword of Rasulullah and he wore torn clothes underneath his abba. When they asked him, Sayyida Zainab asked him, "Oh my brother Hussein, why do you wear torn clothes under your abba?" For Imam al-Hussein said, "I wear the torn clothes such that nobody will steal my clothes after my death." He called for all his women and all his children and began to give them the final wasiyah. At the last moment, he asked to see his youngest son, 6 month Ali Yunil Asghar. So Sayyida Zainab brought Ali Yunil Asghar and she said to him, "His mother has not been able to feed him for 3 days. Perhaps the enemies will feed him with water." Imam al-Hussein went with Ali ibn al-Asghar into the battlefield and sought water for his child. He said, "Oh Shimar, if there is a sin for the elders, what is the sin of this child?" Shimar looked towards Umar ibn Sa'ad. Umar ibn Sa'ad commanded Hormala to kill the baby with an arrow. Hormala took a three-pronged arrow. He pointed it towards the neck of Ali ibn al-Asghar. He shot the arrow towards the infant. Fadarabahu min al-warid ila al-warid. The arrow entered one side of the neck and came out from the other side of the jugular vein. The blood of Ali ibn al-Asghar was flowing into the arms of the father. Imam al-Hussein took the blood from underneath the neck of Ali ibn al-Asghar. He threw it towards the heavens. Not a single drop of blood fell down to the ground. He took his hand and put it under the neck of Ali ibn al-Asghar for a second time. When the blood filled up in his hand, Imam al-Hussein wiped his face and wiped his beard with the blood of Ali ibn al-Asghar. And then he said, "Ya Allah, this is how I will be erased in the day of judgment, and I shall complain to you what this Ummah has done to me." Imam al-Hussein then came back towards the Khaybagah with the slaughtered infant and was going to bring him back. When Sayyida Zainab came out, she saw Ali Asghar, neck shattered with an arrow stuck inside. Zainab al-Ghura began to hit her head. What a young child is this? What a big arrow did they use? Imam al-Hussein went went towards the back of the Khaymagah. He began to dig a small grave with the sword. He put Ali ibn al-Asghar in the cover and he covered up the grave. The Imam then faced the enemies with his sword. After burying Ali ibn al-Asghar, Aba Abdullah al-Hussein went into the Maidan to perform his jihad. Allah, Allah, Ya Shi'at Ali Muhammad, Ya Shi'at Hussein. The entire hour you have been listening to how the companions and how the families were killed. Now look at the jihad of your master, Aba Abdullah. This is the jihad of the son of Haydar. This is the jihad of the son of Haydar. And Haydar Hussein. The heavens wept blood for the jihad of Hussein. The malaika wept for this jihad of Hussein. Ya Shi'at Ali Muhammad, the arsh of Allah was shaking with the jihad of Hussein. Imam al-Hussein then entered into the Maidan to face the enemies with his sword. He challenged them to a battle. He killed every one of the kuffar that came in front of him until he killed a large number of the enemies. He then attacked the right wing of Umar ibn Sa'ad and dismantled it in its entirety. And then he attacked the left wing, dismantling it in its entirety. He sat on his sword with the sword of the Dhulfiqar. He cried out, Ana Hussein ibn I am Hussein ibn Ali. Ana Hussein ibn Ali. And I have decided I shall never bow down to disgrace. I shall protect my father's family. I will protect Zainab. Abdullah ibn Umar says that I have never seen a person who was surrounded by so much difficulties. I have never seen a person whose companions and family members have been killed remain so strong on the battlefield. A person who has been carrying body after body every day, all this entire day. There was a nur that was radiating from the face of Imam al-Hussein. Umar ibn Sa'ad said, this is Hussein, the son of the quarrelsome one. This is the son of the killers of the Arab. This is the son of Abu Turab. You are not able to counter him if you attack him one by one. So attack him from every direction. 4,000 arrows were shot at Abu Abdullah. They shot 4,000 arrows at Imam al-Hussein. So Imam al-Hussein moved towards the center of the Maidan. As he moved towards the center, a part of the enemies came towards the tent to attack the women. So Imam al-Hussein cried out, O Shias of Al-Sufi Sufiyan, if you do not have any religion and you do not fear the Akhirah, then at least be free men if you are the son of your fathers as you claim. Shimon cried, what are you saying, O son of Fatima? Imam al-Hussein said to them, it is me who is fighting against you. While I am alive, do not harm my women. While I am alive, do not harm my women. And if you are men, then face me in the battlefield. Shimmer Mindal Joshan said, then this is what we shall do. They began to attack Imam al-Hussein with all their numbers in one manner. The battle intensified, but the jihad of Imam al-Hussein was a jihad of his father Ali ibn Abi Talib.
He fought them until he reached the river Furat. He conquered the Furat. The Imam dislodged all the 4,000 forces that were there. And then he said to his horse, he said to the horse, the Dhuljana, you are thirsty and I am thirsty. But Dhuljana, you drink from the Furat. The horse looked back towards its master and began to shake its head. Shivering in the junction from the ranks cried behind, "Oh Hussein, do you think about drinking the water while your women are being attacked?" So Imam charged back towards the Khaymaga to defend the women and protect the women. He attacked the enemies and dispelled them from every manner. And once he entered into the Khaymaga, he bid his family farewell for the last time. He gathered together his wives and his sisters, Rabab and Layla, Umm Kulthum and Zainab. He said to them, "Have sabr." Imam Hussain said to them, "Be prepared for the bala that is going to fall upon you. I wonder which bala Zainab is waiting for. Is it the bala of the hijab or the bala of imprisonment?" Imam Hussain said, "Be ready for the bala and have sabr." As Imam Hussain was coming out, he saw his daughter Sukaina. She was sitting by herself, weeping and crying all by herself in one corner of the Khaymaga. Imam Hussain went towards her and said to her, "Oh Sukaina, do not worry." He hugged his daughter, he kissed her on the forehead, and then he said to her, "Thumma innahu wadda'ahu." وَدَّعَ عَيَادَهُ ثَانِيًا وَأَمَرَهُمْ بِالصَّبْرِ وَكَانَ اسْتَعِدُّ لِلْبَلَاءِ وَإِعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى حَامِيكُمْ. And then he turned towards Sukaina. She was sitting by herself. He said to Sukaina, "هَذَا الْوِدَاءُ وَالْمُلْتَقَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ." "Oh Sukaina, this is my final farewell. We will now meet on يوم القيامة. We will meet at the pond of Kawthar." So Sukaina began to cry. Imam Hussain said to her, "Do not weep for me and be patient while you are taken as a slave and as a prisoner. Oh Sukaina, when you see my body on the plains of Karbala without a head, cut to pieces, Sukaina, have patience." Imam Hussain bid his family farewell. He entered into the Maidan, or while he was bidding Sukaina farewell, Umar ibn Sa'ad cried out to his army, "Oh men, attack Hussain while he is busy with the women. Indeed, if Hussain turns his attention towards you, you will never be able to kill him and conquer him." So they began to shoot arrows while Imam Hussain was in the tent with the women. Some of the arrows even pierced the hijab of the ladies, frightening them with terror. Imam Hussain came out of the Khaymaga like a raging lion, attacking everyone that came on his path. The narration mentions all the enemies began to shoot arrows at Imam Hussain from every direction. The Imam kept saying, "La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah." Imam Hussain was covered with arrows. He stood in front of Shimon and he said to him, "Oh Shimon, at least give water for the children." Shimon said, "Oh Hussain, you will not taste anything but fire." One of the enemies came and he shouted, "Oh Hussain, do you see this Furat? You will never drink a drop of water until you die." Imam Hussain on the battlefield on his horse was attacked with 4,000 arrows shot towards him. Imam Hussain covered in arrows, and then one of the enemies by the name of Abul Utuf, he shot an Imam with an arrow that pierced the forehead of Imam Hussain. blood was pouring down his forehead. Another one of the enemies threw a stone on Imam Hussain. The stone hit the side of the forehead. Blood began to fall down the forehead of Imam. He wiped the blood with his kameez. He wiped the blood with his shirt. And as he was wiping the blood, another one of the enemies shot a three-pronged arrow. It pierced the heart of Imam. Insulted the Imam, and then he struck Imam Hussain with a swoon on the